أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، أيها المسلمون اتقوا الله سبحانه وتعالى حق التقوى، ومسلم ستقوى بالله سبحانه وتعالى ذو التقوى، فذلك تقوى بالله سبحانه وتعالى along with إيمان الله سبحانه وتعالى is a means by which a person attains the wilaya from Allah تبارك وتعالى. As Allah تبارك وتعالى said in the Quran, ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. قال شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى: فكل من كان مؤمنا تقيا كان لله وليا. Have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for verily the muttaqi who believes in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and does what it takes to protect himself from the anger and punishment of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is the ally of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah said, indeed the allies of Allah, there is no fear upon them and nor should they grieve. They are those who believe and have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, and so everyone who has iman and taqwa, meaning a man to a level of iman, of faith, and a level and a man to a level of taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they are the ally of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has negated al-huzn, he has negated sadness from the believers. Verily the affair of sadness and grief and sorrow and depression and anxiety is something that is warded off by the iman of a person. وَمِنْ أَعْضَمِ ثَمَرَاتِ الْإِيمَانِ. And from the greatest fruits of iman and from the greatest fruits of the dhikr of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and from the greatest fruits of a ta'zeem لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, of venerating Allah and recognizing the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that the person who believes, who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who constantly turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who realizes the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then their understanding of these affairs and their contemplation of these affairs will be the greatest of things to remove sadness and grief and depression and sadness and pessimism and everything of the sort from that person. For verily these affairs are from the most dangerous of things for a human being. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said in this tremendous book, Madarij al-Salikin, responding to the claim of some of the Sufis, that al-huzn min manazil al-sa'irin, that sadness is from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that brings a person close to Allah. And that sadness somehow is praiseworthy in Islam. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَلَمْ يَأْتِ الْحُزْنُ فِي الْقُرْآنِ إِلَّا مَنْ هِيَنْ عَنْ أَوْ مَنْ فِيَّهْ. He said that the word sadness has not been mentioned in the Quran except that Allah has forbidden us from being sad and has negated sadness from the believers. ثم ذكر بعض الأدلة على ذلك وقال رحمه الله تعالى: وسر ذلك أن الحزن موقف غير مسير ولا مصلحة فيه للقلب. He said, and after mentioning the evidences from the book of Allah تبارك وتعالى that sadness has been forbidden by Allah and negated from the believers by Allah سبحانه وتعالى, he said, and the secret of that is that الحزن is that sadness, موقف, stops a person in their tracks, غير مسير, and it does not motivate the person or move them forward. ولا مصلحة فيه للقلب, and there is no benefit in being sad for his heart. وأحب شيء إلى الشيطان أيحزن العبد ليقطعه عن سيره ويقيفه عن سلوكه. And the most beloved things Ibn Qayyim رحمه الله تعالى said, and he said elsewhere in his writings, from the most or the most loved thing to the shaitan is to bring sadness to the slave of Allah the worshiper of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, to cause the worshiper of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to be sad and overcome with anxiety and grief and sorrow and so on and so forth. لِيَقْطَعُهُ عَنْ سَيْرِهِ, to cut him off from his journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to stop him in his progress and to make him freeze in his tracks as regards his journeying towards Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. وقال رحمه الله تعالى أيضا في كتابه الفوائد, وجميع القلوب تعود على قلبين, قلب هو عرش الرحمن, يعني استوى عليه المثل الأعلى اعتقاد العبد وإيمانه بالله تبارك وتعالى وبتعظيمه تبارك وتعالى وبعظمته وجلاله تبارك وتعالى. He said that all of the hearts of the creation are one of two hearts. There is a heart, brothers, move close. Barakallahu feekum. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, when it said to you, تَفَصَّحُ فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفْصَحُ يَفْصَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, and when it is said to you, make room in the gatherings, I make room, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make room for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make things easier for you. Barakallahu feekum. The secret of this, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, is that all the hearts are one of two hearts. He said there is a heart that is the arsh of Ar-Rahman tabaraka wa ta'ala. It is the throne of Ar-Rahman. And he explained that what is meant by the throne of Ar-Rahman is that the belief about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala الذي هو مستوي فوق السبع السماوات على عرشه تبارك وتعالى, the one who is above the entirety of the creation, above the most expansive and vast and immense of his creations, which is his throne, the creation at which the entire universe compared to it is like an iron ring thrown into the wilderness or thrown into a field. This vast creation of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is above, he said likewise the belief in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has ascended. The belief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ascended over the heart of the believer. Has ascended over the heart of the believer. And it has control over the heart of the believer. And is on account of that, on account of his belief, just as everything in the universe, the higher you go, the more vast and immense it becomes. He said, likewise, his heart is open and his heart becomes vast. And it is full of al-farah, al-surur, wal-buhja. His heart is full because of his aqeedah, because of his creed. It is full of happiness and it is full of joy and it is full of buhja. He said, وَعَرْشٌ وَقَلْبٌ هُوَ عَرْشُ الشَّيْطَانِ فَهُنَاكَ الذِّيقُ وَالظُّلْمَةِ وَالْمَوْتُ وَالْحَزَنُ وَالْخَمُّ وَالْحَمُّ فَهُوَ حَزِينٌ عَلَى مَا مَضَى مَحْمُومٌ بِمَا يَسْتَقْبِلْ مَغْمُومٌ فِي الْحَالِ. He said, in the second type of heart is a heart that is the throne of a shaitan, a heart that is being controlled by the shaitan, a heart that the shaitan has taken control of. إِيَّاكَ وَإِيَّاكَ يَا عَبْدَ اللَّهِ يَا مُسْلِمْ, أَنْ تُمَكِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ من قلبك فإن القلب منزلة الملك على الجنود. I warn you, O slave of Allah, from allowing the shaitan to take the seat of authority over your heart. For verily, the heart of the person is like a malik. It is like the king over the troops and over the citizenry. And if the shaitan gets control of the king, then you are in checkmate. If the shaitan gets control of your heart, then you have been defeated, and you have been toppled, then you have been overcome. He said there is a heart that is the throne of a shaitan. He said it is a heart that is tight and constricted, a heart that is dark and gloomy, a heart that is dead, a heart that is sad, a heart that is grief-stricken, a heart that is worried. He is sad over the past, and he is worried about the future, and he is stressed out at the moment. It is for the person to understand that difficulty is a fact of life. That difficulty is a fact of life, and sadness and grief and sorrow only makes things worse and exacerbate his difficulty and make things harder for him. It destroys a human being. It destroys a human being when a person is overcome with sadness. And there are some people that this is how they are at all times, and they don't know how to be anything but miserable. They don't know how to be anything but sad. And it's not right unless it's wrong. And this is something that is predominantly, particularly amongst the women. But rarely they are more emotional than the men. And the men have, in general, stronger intellects than the women. And the women have more emotions than the men. Although the men have emotions, and all the women have intellect, the woman, it is known that she is an emotional creature. It is known, Ya Abdullah, that there are things that will stress her out easy, much easier than they will stress you out, that will worry her quicker than they will worry you. It is for you, Ya Abdullah. It is for you, O slave of Allah, Ya Rajul, O man, to protect the heart of your wife. To protect the heart of your wife, and not to put her in a situation where she has to worry about the finances of the home, where she has to worry about every single affair connected to the home. For verily, the relationship of marriage is mutakammil, and it is a relationship of the partners and the spouses completing one another. It is a partnership. It is a partnership. Everybody brings something to the table. What else do you expect your life to be, except for sad and miserable and stressed out if you are a freeloader? What else do you expect your life to be, except for sad and miserable and stressed out if you never show her the hand of concern, if you never listen to her, if you never speak to her, if you never attend to your children, if that becomes her full-time job, and you have no part in that, in the raising and the upbringing and the rearing of your children? We find some women that everything is upon them. And the men, they wonder, and they don't understand why the women are so sad. We say, Iyaka, Ya Abdullah. Woe be to you, Ya Abdullah. We warn you, Ya Abdullah, of giving the shaitan not control over the heart of your wife, but giving shaitan a thaghra, giving the shaitan a wide open gap in the fortress that is supposed to be your family, to destroy your family. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Inna shaytana wada'a arshahu ala al-ma, thumma yab'athu sarayahu, fa'akhrabahu minhu manzila, a'adhamahu fitna. The shaytan has placed his throne over some body of water upon the earth. And he sends out his troops. He sends out his troops, his soldiers, from the shayateen, from the devils of the jinn. And the closest of them, adnahum ilayhi manzila, the ones that are closest to him in status, the ones that have the highest rank in the army of shaitan, are those that cause the greatest fitna. The shaitan doesn't stop with one of you. And so he causes you to make shirk with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and disbelieve in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And he comes to the shaitan and he said, Ma taraktuhu hatta ashraka billah. I didn't leave him until he made shirk with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the shaitan, he said, Ni'ma ant. And he brings him close. You have done well. Congratulations. Congratulations. Bi'sal bisharata hadhi. What a horrible congratulations. And the shaitan has congratulated one of his lieutenants, one of his commanders, one of his generals, for causing the Muslim to leave Islam. And the shaitan has not ceased with one of you until he comes, until the devil comes back to the shaitan. And he said, مَا تَرَكْتُهُ حَتَّى فَرَّقْتُ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ امْرَأَتِهِ. I did not leave him until I split up him and his wife. I do not leave him until I split up him and his wife. Look at these two things that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said they are the reasons for the shaitan to bring his saraya, his junood, close to him and to raise him in rank. This is where they get their stripes. This is where they get their status. This is where they get their rank. أَعْظَمَهُ fitna. Those that cause the greatest fitna, those that cause the people to leave the religion of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala from the devils, and those that split up the Muslim home. Is there anything that is more guaranteed to destroy the lives of the Muslim children and to push them closer to kufr and shirk with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and to blame the problems of their life upon Allah's religion? There's some of the foolishness that we see in the Muslim homes. And some of what we see are the men not taking no responsibility in their home. Istiqamatu ahl al-bayt, usalahu ahl al-bayt in istiqamatu rajul. The rectification of the home, it comes by the rectitude of the man of the home, ya rajul. O Muslim man. And so this affair of sadness and grief and sorrow and stress and the likes of these things, they are arshu shaitan ala qalb al-mu'min. They are the throne of the shaitan, a seat of authority for the shaitan upon the heart of the believer, that destroys the believer, that casts a question upon his iman, that casts questions concerning his patience, questions concerning his gratitude of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, questions concerning his intellect, that he would allow the shaitan to take control over his mind and his emotions. So it destroys the person. It destroys the body of a person and his health. It destroys his organs. It causes a person to have a heart attack, to have a stroke, to have high blood pressure, the likes of these affairs. It destroys his body and it destroys his health. It destroys the morale of a person and a person's personality and a person's character. It destroys the relationship of a person, the marriage of a person, the friendship, the brotherhood, the sisterhood between the believers. This affair of being overcome with sadness and strife and strife and stress and grief and sorrow, it destroys the efficiency of a person concerning the duties in the workplace and concerning his performance. And in general, it destroys, and in summary, it destroys the life of a person entirely. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كان يستعيذ بالله تبارك وتعالى من الهم والحزن وأسبابهما. He used to seek refuge with Allah تبارك وتعالى from sadness and grief and sorrow and all of the things that cause it. He said in a hadith متفق عليه, agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim from the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, قال رضي الله عنه سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لهم إني أعوذ بك من الهم والحزن من الهم والحزن والعجز والكسل والجبن والبخل والضلع الدين وغلبة الرجال. He said, oh Allah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, oh Allah, indeed I seek your refuge from worry and sadness. Worry about the future and sadness about the past. Worry and sadness. Wal-ajiz wal-kasal. And then the other things that he mentioned are the greatest causes of sadness and worry. Wal-ajiz wal-kasal. And I seek your refuge, oh Allah, from helplessness, well, kasal. Helplessness is where a person wants to do the good, wants to do that which will benefit him in his deen and his dunya and his hereafter. However, he does not have the ability. And so it causes him concern about the future. And he is sad about the past and what he was not able to do or she was not able to do. Well, kasal. And laziness is where a person has the ability, but they don't have the irada. But they don't have the determination or the will or the ambition to do what is correct. والجبن والبخل. And I seek your refuge from cowardice and greed. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he informed that these two characteristics are from the most disgusting of affairs. As comes reported by Abu Dawud fi Sunanih, that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, بِئْسَ مَا يَكُونُ فِي الْمَرَى جُبْنٌ هَالِعٌ وَبُخْلٌ جُبْنٌ خَالِعٌ وَبُخْلٌ هَالِعٌ. He said that two worst characteristics that can be found in a man is to have جُبْنٌ خَالِعٌ, is to have unnerving cowardice. To have unnerving cowardice. It is where a person is tried and tested and they tremble and they shake and their mouth cannot open and their tongue cannot move and their hands are mashrula, their hands are paralyzed and their feet are paralyzed. The scholars, they said that the shuja, you dafir amman la ya'lam. They said that the courageous person would defend somebody even if they didn't know them. Wal jabban yafirru min ummihi and he la yadfa hatta an ummihi. While the coward would run away from his own mother, meaning if his mother was being threatened, he would run away from her. And what is worse than that? The ulama of Islam, they say, the worst thing that can be coupled with cowardice, and cowardice is from the greatest reasons of sadness and worry, the worst thing that can be coupled with it is arrogance. As they said that a person is like a lion when he is around the believers, threatening the believers, raising his voice with the believers, antagonizing the believers, and he is an ostrich when he is with other than us. La bi'sa al-khaslatayn wal-khallatayn al-jubn wal-kibr. The worst two characteristics a person can have is to be a coward and be arrogant at the same time. You find people that are like that. In the home they are a tyrant. In the home they are a madman. In the home they are a fool. And they come out into the streets and they are as humble as a kitten. They are as pacifistic as an ostrich. A coward with everyone else. But arrogant against the believers. Arrogant against those people that deserve kind treatment the most from him. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَبُخْلٌ هَالِعٌ. He said, and likewise, I seek your refuge from greed. And in this narration that we heard, the two worst characteristics in a man is unnerving cowardice, وَبُخْلٌ هَالِعٌ, and anguished greed. And what is meant by anguished greed, the scholars say, is that a person, it is not from their sajiya, it is not from their way, at all, aslan, to be concerned about anyone but themselves, or to give anything to benefit anyone, or to support anything of the khair. And if, for some strange reason they do, then they are in a state where they are hali'un, where they are anguished, it hurts them. They squeeze the cord to the eagle's screams. They are greedy concerning their life. They are greedy concerning their children. They are greedy in their community. Miserable people. And if they give something, then they stand over those that they gave it to with al-nanna wal-adha, reminding them of their favors and criticizing them every time they make a mistake. That's why I don't do nothing. Hasbunallah. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sought refuge from this type of characteristic, and this is from the greatest of causes of sadness and worry and grief and sorrow and so on and so forth. He said, wa dhala' ad-dayn wa ghalabat ar-rijal. And I seek your refuge, O Allah, from dhala' ad-dayn wa ghalabat ar-rijal, and from being overcome by debt and overcome by men. By being overcome by debt and overcome by men, you find some of the Muslims falling into the credit card trap, falling into the student loan trap. Everybody and their mother could tell them who went down that road for the last 2 decades. Don't do it, it's a trap. But they think they know better than everyone else. They think that what Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned against doesn't apply to them. And they become overcome by debt with compounded, convoluted interest that they can never pay off. They find themselves paying year after year after year, and at the end of their life, they have just paid the interest. They have just paid the interest. وَغَلَبَتَ الرِّجَالِ. And being overcome by men, without a doubt, is from the greatest causes of sadness and grief. You find people risking their lives and risking their freedom for a quick dollar. Any people risking their lives and risking their freedom for halal or for haram sustenance. It says they're asking Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to suffice them with the halal from the haram. And now they're writing letters from prison. And they're in and out. And they become part of a oppressive, tyrannical system. And this, without a doubt, is something that casts a lot of emotional grief upon the community and sadness upon the community. And when they come out, even, it is difficult for them to make a move. It is difficult for them to make a move. It is upon the person that is overcome by grief and overcome by sorrow to turn to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wahda, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and to recognize the greatness of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested them with, in reality, is very, very small compared to the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that comes from being patient for this test. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك. الحمد لله وحده. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. One of the most beautiful speech to remind us of the reality of the fact that difficulty is a fact of life. And that the only thing that will avail you and benefit you, Ya Abdullah, Ya Muslim, is to find what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has instructed you with, and to act upon the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For verily the affairs, as Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَلَيْسَتْ تَنْزِلُ بِأَهَدٍ مِنْ أَهْلِ دِينِ اللَّهِ نَازِلًا إِلَّا وَفِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ الدَّلِيلُ عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْهُدَى فِيهَا. That there is no person in the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who goes through any difficulty or trying affair, except that the solution of how he is to deal with that thing in the path of guidance as regards his problem is found in the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. It is found in the book of Allah. And we add to that the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without a doubt, was included in the statement of Ash-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala, he reminds us of this affair, that difficulty is a fact of life, and hardship and test is a fact of life. And the solution to our problems is by obeying Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala alone. And grief and sorrow and so on and so forth will avail us to nothing, and will benefit us to nothing, and will harm us more than anything. He said about the statement of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ. Indeed, we created mankind in a state of toil and difficulty. He said, قَالَ عُلَمَاؤُنَا. Our scholars have said, أَوَّلُ مَا يُكَابِدُ قَطْعَ سُرَّتِهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا قُمِتَ قِيمَاتًا وَشُدَّ رِبَاتًا يُكَابِدُ الضِّيقَ وَالتَّعْبَ. He said the first difficulty that he encounters is the cutting of his umbilical cord. And then he is wrapped tight in blankets and swaddling cloth and so on and so forth. And he feels constricted and tired as an infant. ثُمَّ يُكَابِدُ الْإِرْتِضَاعُ وَلَوْ فَاتَهُ لَضَاعُ. Then he goes through the difficulty of breastfeeding. It is hard upon him. He always constantly needs the nursing of his mother. And if he was to lose out on it, Lava', and if he was not to be suckled by his mother, and then he would be ruined. He said, ثُمَّ يُكَابِدُ نَبْتَ أَسْنَانِهِ وَتَحَرُّكَ لِسَانِهِ. And then he encounters the difficulty of his teeth growing. and having to learn how to speak. The embarrassment of learning how to speak. ثم يكابر الفطام الذي هو أشد من الإطام والإطام الضرب في الوجه. He said, and then he encounters الفطام. He goes through the difficulty of being weaned from the milk of his mother, which is more difficult upon him than being pushed in his face. ثم يكابر الختان والأوجاع والأحزان. And then he encounters the difficulty of being circumcised. And all sorts of pain in his body. And all sorts of sadness as he grows up as a child. ثم يكابر المعلم وصولته والمؤدب وسياسته والأستاذ وحيبته. And then he must deal with the difficulty of his teachers. And they're being hard upon him for the good. They're being hard upon him. And in his disciplinarians and how they deal with him. والأستاذ وحيبته. And in his teachers. And having respect for them and having to always show subservience for them. ثم يكابر شغل تزويج وتعجيرته. And then he goes through the difficulty. Then he goes through the difficulty of trying to get married. And hastening to get married. ثم يكابر شغل الأولاد والخدم والأجناد. And then he goes through the difficulty of being busy with his children. And being busy with his servants, or in the cases of people these days, their employees, what ajnad, and then having service in the military and so on and so forth. ثم يكابر شغل الدور وبناء القصور. And then he is busy with building his home and securing a homestead for his family. ثم الكبر والحرم. And then he reaches old age and the age of senility. وضعف الركبة والقدم. And the weakness of his knees and his feet. في مصائب يكثر تعدادها ونوائب يطول إيرادها من صداع رأس ووجع الأضراس ورمد العين وغم الدين ووجع السن وألم الأذن. And then he finds that he goes through all sorts of difficulties as an elderly person. There are too many to count. His head hurts, and his molars hurt. His vision becomes blurry, and he is overcome with debts that he must pay before he dies. His teeth start to hurt, and his ears start to hurt. وَيُكَابِدُ مِحَنًا فِي الْمَالِ وَالنَّفْسِ مِثْلَ الضَّرْبِ وَالْحَبْسِ. And throughout his life, he goes through difficulties and tests concerning his wealth and concerning his property. Maybe he is beat. Maybe he will be imprisoned. وَلَا يَمْضِي عَلَيْهِ يَوْمٍ إِلَّا يُقَاسِ فِيهِ شِدَّةً وَلَا يُكَابِدُ إِلَّا مَشَقَّةً. And there is not a day of his life except that he goes through some hardship and hardness in that day in his life. ثُمَ الْمَوْتَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ كُلِّهِ. And then after all of that he dies. ثُمَ مَسْأَلَةَ الْمَلَكِ. And he is questioned by Munkar al-Nakir in his grave. وَضَغْدَةَ الْقُبْرِ وَظُلْمَتَ. And the grave is tight upon him and in his deck. ثم البعث والأرض على الله. And then he is resurrected and presented in front of Allah تبارك وتعالى for judgment. إلا أن يستقر به القرار إما في الجنة وإما في النار. Up until he takes his abode either in the paradise or either in the fire. قال الله تعالى لقد خلقنا الإنسان في كبد أيحسب أن لا يقدر عليه أحد. Allah said, and we created mankind in a state of toil and difficulty. Does he think that no one has power over him? Does he think that none have power over him? He said, this means, فَلَوْ كَانَ الْأَمْرُ إِلَيْهِ لَمَا اخْتَارَ هَذِهِ الشَّدَائِدِ. He said, meaning if the affair was in his hand, if he was truly in control of his life as he believes, he would never have chosen to go through any of those difficulties. وَدَلَّ هَذَا عَلَى أَنَّ لَهُ خَالِقًا دَبَّرَهُ وقضى عليه بهذه الأحوال فليمتثل أمره. And this shows him and proves to him that every day of his life that he has a creator that is in control of his affairs and that has decreed for him to go through these different circumstances and states in his life. فليمتثل أمره. So let him fulfill the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let him find what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him. As the ulama they say, كن كما أراد الله يكونك فوق ما تريد.
be as Allah wants you to be, and Allah will be for you above what you could ever want for yourself. It is for the person to know that the only solution to his sadness and his grief and his sorrow is obedience to Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم إننا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى والآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.